this afternoon. But what I want to talk about now is menopause and the pensions. Now, today is World Menopause Day. It's on the 18th of October every year, and its purpose is to raise awareness of the menopause and the support options for improving health and well-being. So I'm going to start off by saying that 49.7% of the world's current population is female. In the UK, it's slightly higher. We have approximately 30.4 million women in the UK. You're either going to be a woman or you'll know a woman. Menopause is a fact of life, but what is it? Well, the menopause is a natural biological process. It's the result of changes in the levels of a hormone called estrogen, which cause menstrual periods to stop permanently so that pregnancy is no longer possible. And it's a natural phase in every woman's life that needs to be normalized. Now, around 1 in 100 women will experience the menopause before 40 years of age, but it does generally happen between the ages of 45 to 55, with the average age being 51. Most guidance suggests that symptoms will last around 4 to 7 years. Now, it may shock you to know that the highest rates of suicide for women in the UK last year were for those aged between 45 and 49, and the average age of divorce for women was 42. In terms of divorce, the average age for divorce for women was 42. You're probably wondering, though, what the menopause has got to do with pensions. Well, you may be interested to know that women on average live longer than men but have half the pension benefits, and that can be for lots of different reasons. It could be taking time out to look after children or perhaps caring for elderly relatives. Perhaps it's because women are working part-time. 75% of part-timers are women, and there is a gender pay gap. And in terms of divorce, women are more likely to waive their rights to their partner's pension, and only 3% of women seek financial advice as part of their divorce. As a government advisor recently warned, there is a pensions crisis looming. Nearly 1 million women are retiring early due to their menopause symptoms. And research suggests that a quarter of women with menopause symptoms have left their job. So how much money would you need to be able to retire? Well, it's a very difficult question to answer because each of you will have very different circumstances, but we thought you might find this interesting. So research was commissioned by the Pension and Lifetime Savings Association to see what kind of income might be needed in retirement. And the research was carried out by Loughborough University, who communicated with around 2,000 individuals. Now, these individuals were already in retirement. They were from all walks of life and from all over the UK. And their findings were set out in 2018 and updated last year, so before the cost of living really spiraled. But their findings set out 3 suggested levels of expenditure in retirement. Now, the figures that I'm going to look at assume that you live outside of London, that you have no mortgage or rent to pay, and are based on the cost last year when the cost of living was lower. If you live in the London area, you'll see on the slide the amounts needed are higher. But the idea is it gives you sort of an indication of how much income you might need in retirement. So, for example, a minimum lifestyle, which would cover all your basic utilities, you wouldn't have a car, but you might have some left over. So, for example, you could maybe holiday in the UK for a week a year, maybe eat out once a month at a very basic restaurant and have a weekly shop of around £40 a week. Then for that sort of minimum lifestyle, if you're a single person living outside of London, you need an income of around £13,000 a year. And if you were in a couple, that would be around £20,000 a year. But you might be thinking you want a more comfortable retirement, something that perhaps provides you with more financial security and flexibility, so that you could maybe have one car. Maybe you could have 1 week's foreign holiday a year, and maybe you'd be able to eat out a few times a month in a better restaurant, have a weekly shop of around £50 a week. which would give you the opportunity perhaps to do more of the things that you want to do. So if you're single and living outside of London, you may require an income of around £23,000 per year. And if you're in a couple, then that would be around £34,000 a year. But you might be like me, who wants a luxurious retirement, providing more financial freedom. So the kind of lifestyle that would allow you to be more spontaneous with your money, so that you could, in addition, maybe have a subscription to a streaming service. You could maybe have regular beauty treatments, maybe a couple of foreign holidays a year, and a weekly shop of around £60 a week. If you're single and living outside of London, you may require an income of around £30,000. Oh, there's something gone wrong with the... Has everybody got their microphones off? That was... Can you all hear me okay? Can you hear me? Yep.
Yeah, we can. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So if you're, you know, to have a luxurious lifestyle, you're looking at about 37,000 if you're single and 55,000 if you're in a couple. But as I said previously, how much money you'll need will depend very much on your own personal circumstances. And of course, if you did have a mortgage or rent to pay, that could make a huge difference. And you can check out the retirement living standards in more detail by following the link on the slide. So when it comes to retirement, you really need to consider the type of lifestyle you want and take into account the amount of savings that you've got in addition to your state pension. So, you know, what kind of lifestyle would you want? What would you like to do? Now, in retirement, as I've said, I'd love to live in luxury. I'd like to be able to go on big holidays. To be able to tick them off as we go, we've got three on the fridge, would be amazing. But is a luxurious lifestyle realistic for me? Is the retirement that you strive for realistically achievable with the retirement savings you have? So consider the type of lifestyle you want in retirement and how much money you might have to live on. To see what you're on track to get from your retirement savings, you can use our budget worksheet and calculator, which you'll see a link to at the bottom of this slide. So how can menopause affect your pension? Well, your menopause symptoms might make you think about changing your work in several ways. You may think about retiring early because you can't cope with work any longer. You may consider partial retirement or reducing your hours, and that might be because you're just too tired to continue with your work on your current basis or hours. It might make you think about changing your role to something less physical or less stressful. It might mean that you don't apply for promotions. It may even make you think about moving away from your current permanent role to agency work or become self-employed. Now, any of us might want to change our jobs at any time in our lives and for many reasons. And menopause can be a time when many women struggle with their jobs. And if this is the case for you, it's really important that you think about your options, especially as some decisions can be irreversible. Options such as retiring early or reducing your hours won't just affect your current income, but it affects the income that you'll get for the rest of your life. Anything that means your salary is lower will have an effect on your pension unless you compensate for that by paying in extra. So you need to consider things very carefully. Your menopause symptoms might be temporary and treatable, so thinking about them like that rather than them being a permanent change might be helpful. It's important to give yourself time to think things through calmly. Brain fog, anxiety, and exhaustion can affect our ability to make decisions. And I know that for sure. And for anyone that was on the earlier call will have heard this. But I had a hysterectomy, which meant the menopause came on very quickly for me. And as a result of that, I had both physical and mental symptoms, and it made my life very difficult. So apologies for all those that have heard it before. But yes, within my role at work, I was commuting into London every day. I was having to get on a crowded train. I was having hot flushes. There was nowhere to sit. And then when I got off the train, I was literally running the 20 minutes that I needed to get to the office to go to the loo. It was no joke. And then after all that, I had to do a full day's work and then go through the whole thing again on the train going home. But I also had all of my other out of work commitments. In addition to all that, I had constant headaches and it made me feel really anxious. So as a result, I couldn't sleep. I was worrying. I couldn't cope. I'm wondering if it sounds familiar to any of you. But what it meant was I was thinking of actually leaving work. But this all happened just before COVID, and I found myself working from home, which was a lot easier than getting on a train and all that business. But it also gave me time to contact my doctor over Teams, and she was able to contact me much easier. So I got support from my doctor, and she gave me much needed HRT. So for me, my bad symptoms were temporary. I can't say, you know, HRT has been a miracle cure. It certainly helped. It's been brilliant. But I still, you know, I'd still have other symptoms. But what it meant was I was able to continue at work. I was able to continue on the same hours and pay. And my employer changed my contract to permanent home working. Knowing your options and talking them through with perhaps me or one of my colleagues at MoneyHelper without judgment could be really helpful. So I'm going to pass over to Philippa now for the next part of our presentation. I was just about to go through all those slides, Philippa, sorry.
It's all right. No, I don't mind. Thank you very much, Nina. So good afternoon, everybody. What I'd like to do is chat through the different, mainly talk about defined benefit schemes, because we had the defined contribution talk seminar this morning, but I'll just briefly explain what they are. So I'll actually start with the defined contribution type of pension, which are basically workplace pensions or even private pensions that you might have other than the public sector. So basically you would put money in, your employer will put money in, and that money is being invested, and you would choose the different investment options, and hopefully over time that pot of money will grow. It can go up or down on a daily basis, but in a defined contribution scheme you are taking the investment risk. When you come to retire, generally you can take out 25%, one quarter of the pension pot can be taken as a tax-free lump sum, and there's lots of different options as to how you can draw the remaining 75% out. When you get the slide, you'll be able to click on the link to find out more about defined contribution. But as we said, we'd like to concentrate this afternoon on defined benefit. And there's two general types of defined benefit. Historically, defined benefits were final salary schemes where the pension was based on your salary and service, and it was your final salary, so either your salary in, say, the last 12 months or averaged over the 3 years prior to retirement. So that was why it was called a final salary. And these schemes give you a guaranteed income for life. But I will explain a career average scheme. We'll go into a bit more detail shortly. But a career average revalued earnings schemes, or CARE for short, mainly in the public sector, gives you a percentage of your salary in each year. So as your salary goes up each year, you get a percentage of that as pension. But in both cases, defined benefit is a guaranteed income for life. So when you come to retirement, you will get a quote as to how much your pension will be. You will also be able to take a tax-free lump sum with a reduced income. You can also retire early. But if you're having it paid early, generally the pension is reduced because the pension scheme is having to pay it out longer. So that's the general principles of final salary and career average, my defined benefit as an overall summary compared to defined contribution. So defined contribution, you take the investment risk, and defined benefit, you have the guaranteed income for life. Now, I think most of you attending this afternoon will be in the public sector. And if we'll be aware of, or might have heard of, something called the McLeod judgment. Now, I'll give you just a brief bit of background to this. So for those of you who are in the pensions, your public sector scheme, in 2015, there was changes to public sector schemes, and most of them changed from final salary to care schemes. And there was a provision that for members of the scheme who were within 10 years of retirement in 2015, they could stay in their existing scheme and not move to the new scheme. Now, in 2018, there were some court cases, and this was found, and one of them was the name of McLeod, was found to be age discriminatory, because this was discrimination against younger members, because they had to join the care scheme. They couldn't stay in the final salary ones scheme. So there's since this judgment, the McLeod judgment, there's been a lot of consultation as to how this can be remedied in relation to everybody who was in the public sector. So the conditions are, in relation to this remedy, that if you were in a public service, a public sector pension scheme at the end of March 2012 and remained in service in 2015, then you will be, then you will be affected by it. And you will be given a choice when you come to retire. You will be given a choice of which scheme you would then like to be in, so you can get the better of your old legacy final salary scheme or the new career average scheme for the service between 2015 and 2022. Now, this might sound quite complicated, and there will be a huge number of calculations having to be done for every single member of a public sector pension scheme. So if you're in the situation where you are in the public service sector scheme between 2015 and 2022, you will in due course be getting information about your options. So you don't need to do anything now, and your pension scheme will contact you. But if you're retiring very shortly, you will be given the options of what to do with regard to your particular situation. So all I can say is that please wait until you get the letter. If you're young, then it's going to be quite a number of years. You will be still in the care scheme from 2022, because that's everybody. It's only the period of service between 2015 and 2022 that is actually affected. So you will be getting options in due course when you are close to retirement, because you will then be able to see the different changes in the benefits, and you can choose which option you'd then likely you would like to be in. So can be quite complicated, but hopefully the information you'll be given will be fairly clear as to what you can do. So let's just explain in a bit more detail how a final salary scheme works. It would be based on a formula relating to your salary and service in that particular scheme. So many public sector pension schemes are based on what we call an accrual rate. So that's how much you earn each year. So we're going to use this example of 1/80th. So Lisa retires after 25 years service on a final salary of £40,000. So her pension, based on her 25 years service, multiplied by her salary and divided by that 80, which is the accrual rate, so she will get a pension of £12,500 a year, payable from age 60. And she can give up some of that £12,500 for a tax-free lump sum. So we haven't done that calculation, but it might be, for example, a pension of £10,000 plus a lump sum of, say, £40,000 or £50,000. So you will be given that option for you to decide what you want to do. So that's why it's final salary, because that £40,000 in this situation is her salary close to retirement. Okay, so if we move on as to what Nina was explaining, if unfortunately you might be suffering from the menopause and you're thinking about how you can adjust your working life, so how might this affect your final salary scheme? So if you decided to work part-time, then your pensionable service is adjusted for your part-time years. So you still get all the service you have full-time. And then if you say worked half-time, so 50%, then that service where you were working part-time, you, if it was 10 years, then you'd get 5 years worth effectively. If you do reduce your hours, it doesn't affect all the previous years. As I said, it only affects the service going forward. So don't worry about it changing what you've already done. It's only going to be for that period where you do work part-time. And if, as Nina was explaining, the menopause might hopefully only be a temporary situation, you might then decide to go back full-time, and then your service is then in bits. You've got your full-time service, then your part-time service reducing, and then back to full-time. So your total pensionable service takes account of those different periods. If you did go part-time, then effectively your salary would still be on the same salary, but it might only be, say, half because you've reduced your hours. So it's always based on your full-time equivalent salary. So that might affect your final salary pension, because it's the final salary that might change. It won't change the rate. It won't change your rate of pay immediately, but it's the definition of that final salary. As I explained, sometimes it's just the last 12 months, or it could be a 3-year average. So you need to check with your particular pension scheme, what is the definition of final pensionable salary? So you can see whether adjusting your hours or your final pensionable pay in the last few years might have an impact on your final salary pension amount. So that's just a brief summary of your final salary and changing your situation. Now let's move on to the career average scheme. How does that work? So it's slightly different. You still have an accrual rate. So that's, in this situation, we're talking about 1/54th of your salary, and you get that for each year based on your salary in that particular year. Not your final salary, it's each year as you go forward. So in this example, we've got a lady who's on 30,000 at the current time. So she earns 1/54th of that. So that's £555 in year one. In year two, she's had a little bit of a salary increase, and it's gone up to 30,500. So she gets 1/54th of that in year two. So that gives her £565 a year. So for those 2 years that we're looking at, she's got year one, 555, and that is increased or revalued, as we say, to take account of inflation. Because if that was when you're, say, 30 years old, the time you get to 60, 65 or 67, that's not going to have much impact if it was not inflation linked. So we revalue them every year to take account of inflation. So in this example, £555 in year one plus a 3.5% inflation increase brings it up to 574. So at year end of year two, we've got £574, which is the revalued amount, plus the actual amount from year two of £565, gives us 1,139. So this carries on. We get these building blocks for each year you're accumulating pension. So that's why we've got, as I said, these building blocks. So each year you're getting, you know, in this case, 10 years, you've got each year of service, your 10 years, 1/54th plus revaluation from year one, you'd have 9 years, from year two, you'd have 8 years worth, etc. So you've got these little blocks adding up to your total care pension the time you get to retirement. In both cases, sorry, if we just go back slightly, I was going to say that if you were to take your pension early, in both the final salary and the career average scheme, they will reduce it for each year you retire early. And again, you would need to check with your particular pension scheme, what is this early retirement reduction? Because they're having to pay it for longer, so you get less for each year. And if you take it later, conversely, you'll get more pension. Fine. So what can you do to I think we're going to now be moving on to I've just got one more slide to go through and then we will go on. I'll move on to Nina. So if you reduce your hours or salary, that won't change what you've earned in the past. It's only the salary in that particular year in which you've gone part-time or you've reduced your hours, so your salary is lower. It doesn't change what you've built up, but it will affect the pension you earn in the year in which you've reduced your hours or salary. So if, for example, you earn £20,000 a year, you would build up £370 of pension, but what you've already earned in building blocks 1 to 6 hasn't changed. You're still getting inflation linking of that, but in years 7 to 10, if you've reduced your hours, then the pension you earn in those particular years is based on the lower salary. So always check with your pension scheme specifically how much that will impact on the future pension. So I'd now like to go back to Nina, who will talk about early retirement a bit more.
Thank you very much, Philippa. So as Philippa explained, this defined benefit pension scheme gives a guaranteed income at retirement, and the calculation is based upon pensionable salary and your salary. It's pensionable service, sorry, and your salary. So what about taking early retirement from this type of scheme? Well, as the slide says, it's a very tempting offer when you're old enough, but it is an irreversible decision. And we have a little example on the slide, which I'll talk you through. So Lisa, her normal retirement age within her scheme is 60. She's done 25 years service and her salary is £40,000. Now the accrual rate for her scheme is 80th. So it's a fairly kind of straightforward calculation. It's 25 years times 40,000 divided by 80, which would give Lisa a pension payable of £12,500 for the rest of her life. Now, if Lisa decides to retire early, after just 20 years service, sorry, I meant to say 25. Did I say 25? But it's 25 years in the previous example. But if she retires early, 5 years early, after 20 years, the calculation looks the same, 20 years times 40,000 divided by 80. But you will, if you worked it out yourself, you'd actually think, well, that's £10,000 a year. It's not the £7,900 shown on the screen. But that's because that £10,000 has been reduced by an early retirement factor, which Philippa alluded to. Now, the principle will be the same for all defined benefit schemes, whether it's final salary or career average revalued earning scheme, a care scheme. But the normal retirement age and reduction factors will vary. So things to consider, well, taking early retirement has a kind of treble whammy on retirement income. The first thing is you would have built up less pension because you stopped paying in. The second thing is by taking it earlier, it needs to be paid for a longer period. So you get less per year because that early retirement factor is applied. And the third thing is you miss out on your salary income. So those are really important things to consider with early retirement. If you're in ill health, then it may be possible to take your pension early with no reduction. But in those circumstances, you know, you'd need to speak to your manager and get the pension scheme trustee's approval, as there's certain criteria you'd need to fulfil with ill health early retirement, and they'd be set in the scheme rules. So what else should you think about? Well, maybe your menopause symptoms are causing you to think about leaving your employment. But if you think about them as temporary, could you instead consider maybe just taking some sick leave? Could you take a career break just to let your symptoms kind of settle down while maybe you're having conversations with your doctor? Sick leave or career break? Could you have a temporary role change? Make things a little bit easier while you're going through these symptoms. Maybe your employer could make some adjustments to help you continue to work. So as I mentioned in mine, I was able to work from home, didn't have to do that horrible journey on the train and things. So As I say, I was seriously thinking of leaving. But as I said to you, I was able to continue on the same hours and pay. So check out if your employer has introduced a menopause policy. That will cover what support you can expect to receive during this time, or you could speak to your manager or HR department. You could consider paying more into your pension to compensate from the long-term effects of reducing your hours or salary. If at the end of the day you did decide to leave your employer and look for another job, then please consider the pension and other benefits. Don't just look at a salary. At MoneyHelper, we don't provide financial advice, but it's safe to say we would strongly suggest that you take time to think about decisions relating to your pension. It's particularly important to not rush into anything if you are feeling these menopause symptoms. But if you do decide to leave and you want to understand your pension options, give us a call at MoneyHelper. We won't tell you what you should do, but we can help explain the differences. Okay, so you might think to yourself, I want to pay more into my pension. And that could be for lots of different reasons. It might be that you want a more luxurious retirement. It could be you want to reduce your hours, but still, you know, have enough money for retirement. So there's various different ways you can do it. So with the money, you could money purchase additional voluntary contributions. Now, these are abbreviated to AVCs, and you may have heard them. So an AVC is basically a defined contribution pot of money that gets invested. So a defined contribution pension, as Philippa mentioned earlier, is where your money gets invested and the value of those investments might go up, might go down. But with AVCs, you can pay in lump sums or you could make regular contributions. So sort of top up your other pensions, if you like. Now, with AVCs, there's no guarantee what level of income you'll get at retirement. So it's something you need to closely monitor. But when you come to access your pension, you've got flexible retirement options. So with your main defined benefit schemes, as Philippa said, you know, you get options of generally to get in a full pension payable for life. And then another common option is to get a reduced pension payable for life and a tax-free lump sum. There isn't flexibility with a defined benefit pension in the same way that you can get with AVCs. You've got much more choice of what you can actually do with that money when you come to access it. And if you wanted to, you could join a separate defined contribution scheme. Alternatively, you could potentially buy additional pension. Now, this depends on the type of scheme that you're in. But if you're in the NHS, for example, there is options to do this. But you'll need to check with your pension administrators if you can buy additional pension. And what that means is you can buy a set amount of additional pension. There's often limits, but it's an amount payable per year. So that's something to consider. And you can buy pension to cover a period of unpaid leave, for example. So if you were thinking of going on a career break for a year, perhaps you could purchase the pension to cover that. But there are limits on how much extra pension you can build up. And that's why I say if you're interested in the additional pension, then speak to your pension scheme administrators. Okay, so tracing old pensions. There is literally billions of pounds of unclaimed pension money sitting with pension providers. Could you have any other pensions out there? Now, I mentioned this in the last presentation, but when I first started at MAPS and I started learning about the pension tracing service and so on, I did speak to my sister about it, who said she didn't have any other pensions. But I said to her, just make a list of your employers, tick off the ones you know you've got pensions with, but for any other employers, check them out on the pension tracing service. And this is a true story. She did. She found two and they were worth over £30,000 each. Now, she didn't even remember being in those pension schemes. A lot of older pension schemes were non-contributory. So you haven't got the contributions coming out. So it could be maybe that you've got missing pensions out there. And it's really easy to lose track of your pensions, especially if you've had quite a few employers over the years. So to help you look for a lost workplace pension, and if you know the name of the employer or the pension scheme, you can contact the Pension Tracing Service. Now, that is a government department that holds a register of most pension arrangements, and you can search their register online yourself. You'll see a link on the slide, or you can phone them, and they can hopefully provide you with contact details to make further inquiries. Now, the Pension Tracing Service don't hold details of individual pension savings, so they can't confirm whether you do have pension savings or how much they're worth. But if you do find any, ensure that the pension providers have got your current address and ask them to send you out a statement of entitlement. Now, there is no central place at the moment where you can put in your national insurance number, your name, and it will bring up all those pensions that you may have. Now, the government are working on the pensions dashboard, which will be listing all scheme benefits for an individual. So it's something that will be around in the future, but it's not here at the moment. So the Pension Tracing Service is a really good starting point. Now, when you found your pensions, you can leave them where they are, or if you wanted to, you could transfer them to a different pension provider, because, you know, you may want to combine your pensions, and that's easier to do with defined contribution pensions than the defined benefit pensions that we've been talking mainly about today. Now, just to bear in mind, it's only from 2012 onwards that employers were included in automatic enrolment. Before that, there may not have been a scheme. So just because you worked for an employer pre those dates doesn't mean that you've got a pension scheme with them. It's still worth looking into. You've got nothing to lose. And as I say, there's billions of pounds in pensions sitting with providers. Okay, so pension scams and how to spot them. Every day I speak to people that have lost their pension money due to scams. A very common way for scammers to get in touch is to be contacted out of the blue. Anyone who contacts you out of the blue about your pension will be a criminal, because it's illegal to cold call in connection with pension. So if you get contacted, doesn't matter how nice they are, how much they know about you, end the conversation immediately, report them to the Information Commissioner's Office, and they can investigate. Another way pension scammers operate is by applying pressure to make quick decisions. Beware of anyone who's guaranteeing high investment returns. A very big pension scam is getting access to pensions before the age of 55. Now, the only time you can access a pension before the minimum age, which is currently 55, it's going up to age 57 in 2028, is if there is a protected retirement age on the policy. So some of you in the NHS scheme, for example, in the 95 scheme, you may have protected retirement ages. The only other time that you can access a pension before the minimum age is sometimes if you're in ill health. Anyone who says they can get you access to a pension before the minimum age, if it's not for those reasons, it's likely to be a scam. If you do access your pension before the minimum age and it's not for those reasons, HMRC can fine up to 55% of the value of the pot. So really, really beware of anything like that. I know in these times of austerity, it's very tempting because people can have, you know, substantial amounts in pensions, but just bear that in mind. Beware of offers or mentions of one-off investments, any time limited offers. Beware of anyone who's offering an upfront cash incentive. But also, another way pension scammers will try and get you on board is by offering a free pension review. They'll also use wordings around legal loopholes or government initiatives. Now, the Financial Conduct Authority have got some really good information on their website on how to avoid pension scams. So that's really worth checking out. If you think to yourself, is it a scam or isn't it? Have a look on the FCA website. You can always ring our helpline, which is 0800 011 3797. And Philippa will be giving you out some phone numbers at the end. But if you're not sure, stop what you're doing. Check it out first. If it sounds too good to be true, and I'm sure Philippa will agree with me on this, it normally is, isn't it?
Definitely, yes. Okay,
so yes, I'm going to pass back over to you, Philippa, for the last part of the presentation.
Okay. Thank you very much, Nina. So hopefully we've given you a lot of food for thought this afternoon. So there's things perhaps you can think of to action. So I'll just go through a few of them here. So Nina's covered all about tracing lost pensions, because as you get closer to retirement, the important thing is to understand how much you've got in your pension, what sort of level of income, how much your pension pots are. And as she said, please, please do keep any change of addresses up to date with the pension providers, because otherwise you'll find you'll get to age 60, 65, 67, and you suddenly think, oh, I had a job when I was 20. Who was that with? What is there any pension there? Please just keep, even if it's just one piece of paper with all your pensions and contact numbers, that's a good thing to do. You can always refer back to it and add any, if you change jobs in the future as well, add in any new pensions. We haven't mentioned actually this afternoon yet, but I'll do that now, is your state pension. Most, pretty well everybody should be entitled to some level of state pension. The maximum amount is currently £203.85 a week. So that will give you about £10,600 a year. And you can check your state pension forecast using that web link, and also what your state pension age is. At the moment, it's age 66 is the earliest. And as if you're much younger, it might be 67 moving on to 68, because over a period of time, the government has been moving up that state pension age because we're all living longer and it costs a lot of money for the government to pay us all our state pension. And there's also, you've probably heard today about inflation. Will there still be the triple lock on the state pension increases? So we'll have to wait and see what will be happening, because they always use the September inflation figures to change the amount of pension in the following April. We also get lots of questions. Can I take my state pension early? Because Nina's explained that you can always take your private pension, workplace pension from age 55 or 57 in the future. But with your state pension, you cannot get it early. You can defer it, but it cannot be paid before your state pension age. So that's another thing for you to check out, so you can just work out your finances a bit more. Another thing to note is about the death benefits. Now, we don't want to be too morbid this afternoon, but in your current employments, there may very well be a lump sum death benefit relating to perhaps multiple of your salary being paid. And it's very important to fill in what's called either a nomination form or an expression of wish form, because then you can nominate your beneficiaries under both your existing and previous pension schemes, because there might, you know, will be death benefits there. It could be just a return of your contributions from a defined benefit scheme, or if it's a defined contribution scheme, then it will be the whole fund value. And the whole idea is that under a pension scheme, generally they are free of inheritance tax. So any pension lump sum benefits are outside of your estate, so there will be no inheritance tax. And the pension scheme trustees or the pension company will use their discretion to pay out the money in accordance with your wishes. And the reason they use their discretion is so that it is free of inheritance tax. If you die before 75, there is also no income tax payable in any lump sum benefits, but any benefits paid after 75 are subject to income tax at the rate for your beneficiaries that they pay income tax. So there's a few things for you to action at the moment. Also, going back to Nina's, I think one of her very first slides is to see what pension you might have, or working out what income you might have. We've got a number of calculators on our website, so you can see whether you're on track to get the sort of income you're looking for, or whether you would like to start considering paying some more pension contributions to increase your benefits by way of, say, additional voluntary contributions. And also we have a budget planner, so you can think about what sort of income do you need. Are you sort of on the minimum level, or do you want a good lifestyle in your retirement, have lots of foreign holidays, or what sort of other expenses might you have? So our budget planner goes through things in real detail. as to the sort of expenditure you have, so you can check what you're actually paying now. Will that change in the future? Because once you retire, you're going to have more free time. So will you have more time to go out, enjoy yourself? And will that cost more money and do more of your hobbies that you might not have had time to do while you've been working for the last 30, 40 years? So that budget planner is a really useful way of keeping track of your spending now. And also bring in, if you have a partner, then use their details as well, because as a couple, then you'll have your joint income to look at, and it might be useful for them to consider what their pensions might be as well. But if you need any help whatsoever, we're here to help you. That's our ethos. We're here to help. And our phone number is on this slide. So it's 0800 011 3797. That's the specific pensions number for MoneyHelper. And any question, whether you're 20 years old, 90 years old, we don't mind. We're here to help you. And we also do, some of you might prefer to do web chat, then there's the link on noted on this slide to do web chat with us. Now, if you're over 50 years old and you've got any defined contribution pension, even if it's not now, so you might be in the public sector now, but you might have a previous pension, or you've with an employer, or your own private pension that's defined contribution, PensionWise is available to discuss your options, because we explained that with a defined contribution scheme, you have lots of flexibility, more flexibility than with a defined benefit. So PensionWise has been set up by the government to provide free, impartial guidance as to all the options you have with your pension pots of money. So again, we're showing you the number there to make an appointment, or you can go online to make an appointment. All it costs you is an hour of your time. And we do recommend that anybody with a defined contribution pension, whatever the size is, it's always useful to have that discussion with PensionWise to help you understand what your pension options are, because then you can make a more informed decision as to what to do. If you're looking for guidance on what to do with your defined benefit, your final salary or care scheme options, then again, we're here to help. So ring the first number, the 0800 011 3797, to have a chat about your defined benefit options, as we can help you understand it a bit more. We're also all part of MoneyHelper, so our general helpline number is the 0800 138 7777, and there's loads and loads of people there to help you about all sorts of different types of help with relation to money, which we'll come on to just very briefly in a moment. But we've got lots of also guides, new guides to help you, because we're all struggling with the cost of living at the moment. Inflation's high, it's still high, as we heard today. And there's lots of useful fact sheets we can see here. If you're struggling with bills or you're worried about your mortgage, please just do click on all of these guides to help you. Or if you still need to want to chat, you know, some people prefer to speak to a person, that's where we're here to help you with any help. On, you know, it also covers stopping or reducing your pension contributions, which we've been talking about, if you are struggling financially as well. So again, we're here to help. And there's also some other tools. We've talked about the budget calculator and the pension planning one, but there's other things to help you. So which bills should you deal with first? Which are the priorities to make sure they get paid in order to avoid getting into arrears? And we've got a vast number of people can help with debt advice as well, because unfortunately we are finding that more and more people are struggling with debt, and that's again somewhere else where MoneyHelper on the other side of the business can help you with that. They're all there, you know, it's all confidential. They're here to help you. And we can arrange loads of different help with, you know, if you're suffering, you know, family situations like bereavement or divorce, or perhaps parents are going into care homes, or you're trying to help. So many, as you can see on this slide here, there's so many different things we can help you with, explain it. And there's also on our website there's all these different sections that can help you. Lots of people have problems with benefits. How does, if you're receiving benefits and taking your pension, what's the impact of that, for example? Because some benefits are means tested, so it's useful to understand that. So a wide range of topics that we can hear to help you at Money Helper. That's our ethos, to help you. So I think we've come to the end of our actual presentation. So we'd like to open it up to any questions you have. We've seen some in the chat room, but if anybody would like to raise their hand, we will be here to help you.
The only thing I would say, with some of the questions,